Hello student, this is Purushottam Vishwakarma and I welcome you to this new video lecture related to the chapter The Hack Driver. The Hack Driver, and here in today's video we shall discuss about page number 80 and 81. From your textbook. So we are going to discuss page number 80 along with 81 in this video. I would like to remind you, in this chapter there is a newly appointed lawyer whose work is to pass, to serve summons to those who are witnesses in some cases. So he is unable to practice his apprentice, his law. That is why he yearns to go to such a place where, especially in his village, in the countryside, where he could practice his law. He could be called a lawyer, and here he is working as a private detective, quite similar to a private detective. Not only that, sometimes he is beaten by one of those witnesses who are powerful, who are strong. Whenever he went to give summons to them, some of them thrashed him. So let's continue from page number 80. I know that Bill's helpfulness. Who is Bill? Bill is the hack driver, Bill Magnuson. To the young fellow from the city was not entirely a matter of brotherly love. He said it was not only a matter of brotherly love. There was something. What was that? I was paying him for his time. How much? $2. $2 an hour. $2 per hour. In the end, I paid him for 6 hours, so $12, including the lunch hour. So he was calculating every minute he took him for lunch, and he calculated it at what was then a very high price. It was very high price, but he was no more dishonest than I. He says he was more dishonest than that person. He was no more dishonest than I. The narrator was more dishonest. How? I charged the whole thing to the firm. He did not pay from his pocket. He charged those expenses to the firm, not to his pocket. But it would have been worth paying him myself to have his presence. Surely it would have been worth paying him himself to have his presence. He liked his presence, he liked his company. His cheerful country wisdom was very refreshing to a country boy like myself. As I told you, he liked the company of Bill, the hack driver. That is why he said his cheerful company was soothing for him, for a country boy like him. He liked the countryside, who was sick of the city, who was sick of the city life. As we sat on the hilltop looking over the pastures, they were sitting on the hilltop looking over the pastures, grazing lands and creek which slipped among the trees. They were looking at hills, creeks, river, small creek. He talked of New Mullion. He was talking about New Mullion and its people, and painted a picture in words of all the people in it. He told me everything about that countryside, about that town, New Mullion. So he painted a clear picture of the people of New Mullion. And painted a picture in words of all the people in it. He noticed everything, but no matter how much he might laugh at people, he was laughing at people. He was also understood and forgave their foolishness. He also understood their foolishness and forgave them. He described the minister's wife who sang the loudest in church. He described about minister's wife who sang the loudest in the church when she was in debt, when she had borrowed money. He commented on the boys who came back from the college in fancy clothes. When he saw those boys coming from school, colleges, he commented over them. He told about the lawyer whose wife could never succeed in getting him to put on both a collar and a tie on the same day. He also told the story of a lawyer and his wife and how she could not keep him with a collar and a tie together. He made them all live. He painted the picture clearly. On that day I came to know New Mullion better than I did the city. So I understood New Mullion very well in comparison of my city life, and to love it better, I started an affection towards the town, the city, New Mullion, in comparison of the city I lived in. Bill did not know about colleges and cities. Bill was unaware of college and city. He was illiterate, you can simply say. But he had traveled around a lot of the country. He was a very good traveler. He had traveled all around the country and had had a lot of jobs. He had many jobs to do. From his adventures, he had brought back a philosophy of simplicity and laughter. He strengthened me. He brought so many things. He aroused so many feelings inside me. He was an inspiration for me. He strengthened me in that particular town where I was alone. We left that peaceful scene of meadows. We left that peaceful scene where we were sitting together in woods and resumed our search for Oliver Lutkins. Who is Oliver Lutkins? Oliver Lutkins is the person for whom he has got summons, and he is there to serve summons to him. But actually, for his surprise, he will know about it at the end. The person whom he accompanied all the time, who was with him all the time, actually was Oliver Lutkins. The problem was he did not know about it. We could not find him because he was always with him. At last, Bill, concerned, cornered a friend of Lutkins and made him admit what he guessed. So he took him in the corner, cornered him, and made him confess that what he thought. Oliver is gone to his mother's farm 3 miles north. So what he confessed, he guessed that Oliver had gone to his mother's farm some 3 miles north. We drove out there laying plans while we were moving to that place, to his mother's. We were laying plans. I know Oliver's mother. She is a terror. She is very terrible. Bill sighed. He was telling about his mother. I took a trunk out there for her once, and she almost took my skin off because I did not treat it like a box of eggs. She told, she did not treat him like a good carrier boy, like a tonga driver or hack driver. Why? He was not treated very well. Why? because he did not respect the way she was telling him to do. She is about 9 feet tall and 4 feet thick and quick as a cat. He is telling us the description of Oliver Ludkin's mother. Quite healthy, she is 9 feet long, 9 feet tall, 4 feet wide, quite thick, fat lady, and quick as a cat. And she sure can talk, and she can talk as well. I'll bet Oliver heard that somebody is chasing him and he is gone on there to hide behind his mother's skirts. And he says, I am sure Oliver has heard about it, that someone is chasing him, that is why he has gone to his mother's and hiding behind her skirts. Well, we'll try her. We'll try to find her. But you would better let me do it, boy. You may be great at literature and law. And Bill said, boy, let me handle it. I'll manage. Don't worry. You may be better in literature, you may be better in law, but I am better at actual thinking, smearing, real training in swearing. We drove into a poor farmyard. So when we reached over there, we were faced by an enormous and cheerful old woman. Then we saw an enormous and cheerful old woman, quite big lady, who was cheerful. My guide bravely went up to her and said, remember me? Bill went to her. Remember me? I am Bill Magnuson, the carter and the hackman. I want to find your son Oliver. So these words, actually she was his mother, and he created such a plot that she understood what her son wanted to do. So that is why everything happened in this way. I want to find your son Oliver. I don't know anything about Oliver and I don't want to, she shouted. Then she started shouting, no, I don't want to talk about my son. I don't know where he is. She also pretended. She was very good actor. She understood what her son wanted to do. Now look here, we have had just about enough nonsense. This young man represents the code in the city, and we have a legal right to search all properties of this Oliver Ludkins. Then Bill Magnuson once again tried to gracify the lawyer who was with him. Look, this man is a man of law. He has come here to search this house, and we have right to search. We have warrant for search. Bill made me sound very important in a very impressive way, and the woman was impressed. Surely the woman was impressed. She went inside. She retired into the kitchen and we followed. We also followed her. We thought that she was going to show us the way where Oliver Ludkins was heading. She seized an iron from the old fashioned stove, and iron was burning over there, being heated, and she took it up and marched on us shouting, and ran towards us shouting, you search all you want to, come, 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 you want to search, come, if you don't mind getting burned first, I'll burn you all. She shouted and laughed at our frightened retreat, while we were frighteningly running, she was laughing. What happens next? We'll talk about it the next day, that is in next video. Thank you very much.